So when you don't have a strong set of institutions, what do you have to maintain a cohesive unit? Nothing. And these institutions were either a centralized form of government relying on nobles, well, not a centralized, a central source of authority relying on nobles, and that was the structure, right? Like the Savoy is part of the structure in the Croatian lands. So either that, or you have, as I mentioned in the previous lecture, you have a church that unifies through its institutions the identity, the entity that is this land. And they had neither. So this is essential to understand medieval Bosnia, because it's the problem that will continue to plague it, and it will lead to that bloodshed in the 1990s. The fact that it falls between, exactly on the fault lines of the, between these cultures and powers, and it never had a strong sense of, strong source of rule, strong source of authority, and strong set of institutions to shape a common identity. Okay, and let's finish then with, although at a certain point it was an important actor in the area for a short while. And let's end with Serbia, or the Serbians in the Middle Ages. The Serbians in the Middle Ages, remember that there were two smaller states, Raška and Dukla. Anyway, in the 12th century, it is that that one of the rulers, one of the local rulers, you see Raška here, so it's not yet Serbia, but one of these rulers of Raška manages to expand its authority. There you have Serbia, right? So one of these princes, this was Stefan Nemanja. Your book has the name. Stefan Nemanja, who in the 12th century establishes a strong state, expands the territory, that's always what happens, but also does a very important thing. It really establishes the Eastern Orthodox faith, the Eastern Orthodox faith, and the church in Serbia. In fact, he retires to a monastery, becomes a monk. So he's sort of like a Saint Stephen for the Serbs, but looking towards the Eastern Orthodox church. And that's very important, because from now on, the Serbian Orthodox church and that religious identity will become deeply intertwined with the very existence of the Serbian state, of the Serbian identity as a people, right? Because the establishment of the state will be linked to this set of values of Christianity, but Eastern Christianity. On Mount Athos, which is one of the holy places in Eastern Christianity, in Byzantine Eastern Orthodox Christianity, it's today's Greece, different Orthodox people have their own places of worship there, and the Serbians have a sort of a traditional place of worship there that has become, it remains throughout history, a sort of a cultural center in Greece for them. So the Serbian Orthodox Church will become sort of the backbone of what? Of Serbia, or the Serbian identity. And this will be even more so when the Ottomans will conquer the territory. We'll see why. In the 14th century, Serbia is at its highest, largest extent. So 1350, there is Serbia, a power. But again, remember that this is because the specific ruler managed to expand his rule. Like Naples controlled southern Italian peninsula here. You see Naples, this is not Naples, right? But Naples, which is one city, controlled all this area, just like here with Serbia. So Serbian kingdom is the most glorious, you know, in the 1300s, so greatest emphasis. However, to their own misfortune, this is also where the Ottomans crushed the Byzantine Empire, the fall of Constantinople, famously, and then pushed towards the Balkans and take this area over, and will remain there and will control it for 400 or 500 years. 500 years. Will the Serbians disappear? No. And we'll see why. Right? But now you understand why the Battle of Kosovo. Battle of Kosovo, not the name. Kosovo, which was a region in this Serbia, right? In 1389, on the Field of Blackbirds, is the most tragic moment in Serbian history. Because this is when the Ottomans defeat, after pushing and pushing, and many fights are being pushed back, by the way, all of these entities from Wallachia, Transylvania, Moldova, Polish, from Hungarian state, Croatian, they all formed alliances and fought these push from the Ottomans many times, and often with tremendous huge victories. It was all fought here. All of these countries have this shared historical experience of, we have protected Western Europe, and they're just these ungrateful bastards. This is why we don't have all those establishments. You don't have Paris, because we were busy fighting, which gave you the time to build Paris, which is true to a degree, because border areas are always the ones that suffer the brunt of pressures, while the inside areas are the ones that are protected and can flourish. So there is a dimension here. Plus, they also understood themselves as defenders of Christianity. Christianity in the sense of an area of culture, the defenders of Christianity. So the Battle of Kosovo is a tragic moment. Now, in Serbian history, it becomes this dramatic, tragic moment when you lose the state, 1389, and they will only regain it, basically, 500 years later. 550. Takes 500 years to regain statehood. Okay? So you imagine what after it has been at its most glorious. Glorious meaning it conquered Iran. Now you can imagine the impact of this thing. And you will then understand why this word Kosovo and Battle of Kosovo will awaken such powerful emotions in the Serbians of the end of the 20th century. And then we'll see happens there. And in the documents, I posted a famous painting, but remember, the painting was done in 1919, so it's interesting, but it's a painting of the fallen Serbian hero at the Field of Blackbirds, depicting this tragic moment, the Kosovo maiden. Becomes a symbol of Serbian nation. A Serbian nationhood that will be intertwined with tragedy. I mean, it will be built on a tragic moment. The memory of this loss will shape the very Serbian identity. Okay, so this is a short overview. We will continue in the next section with the period between 1400 and 1700.